So now we're looking forward to another great colleague coming in just last night from New York City. Landed last night and slept 3 hours, he told me, but he's absolutely hot and he's on fire to tell you something about what's going on, bot or not, futuring of messaging. He's one of the most and best awarded colleagues in this field, and he's really entertaining, I'm quite sure. We're talking about a guy who works for innovative tech campaigns like brands Pepsi, Gatorade, Honeymate, and countless other billion-dollar brands. We're really happy to have him here. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome TV host CNBC, Mr. B. Bonenbo. I'm fine. You got what I need here.
I got what you need.
You got what I need Hello. Here, right here. See that?
I know. Christian told me I had to take my my jacket off.
So may I help you with that?
I guess I'll take my jacket off. We're selling these T-shirts. That's how I'm making money nowadays. So now that I'm no longer what's up, Cologne? How are you guys? Are you good? Are you good? Come on. A little bit of excitement. It's been 2 years since I've been on this stage. I think it was the exact same stage. I feel like it was the same stage. I'm very excited to be with you guys right now. Again, for those of you who know me, Bon and Bao, for those of you who don't, I'm still Bon and Bao. I was previously chief media and e-commerce officer for a company called Mondelez, which was the largest snack food company in the world. We had some of the world's most amazing brands like Oreos, Wheat Thins, Triscuits, Stride, Cadbury, and then previous to that, I was director global digital for PepsiCo, where I ran our digital media across all of our the global brands. In my role at Mondelez, I was responsible for $2 billion of media spending. We were the seventh largest buyer in the world, as well as I built our billion-dollar e-commerce business, which I took from $65 million to $265 million in the 18 months that I ran it. But my most important job, I believe, at all of these were really how do I identify trends that can transform our business, and how do I force us to execute on it? And so that's basically what I'm going to talk about today. So the idea is bot or not. I'm going to talk about messaging in the future. But the reality is what I'm going to talk about is how do you identify trends and how do you execute on those? Because at the end of the day, that's what moves businesses forward, that's what grows careers, and ultimately, that's what creates exponential growth. And so one of the trends that I did when I first left was I identified the fact that small businesses were not getting access to capital or being able to grow in the current financial market. So I work with LeBron James, we put a show together, and for the last 18 months, I have been working on investing in small businesses and then helping them grow and ultimately put jobs into communities. Before I left Mondelez, I launched what ultimately became the number one live watch show on Fox for the year for last year, which was, interestingly, a guy came to me, they said, look, Bonin, I want to drop a guy out of an airplane with no parachute on, no wingsuit, and he's going to land safely on the ground. Will you do that? I said, yes, I will do that. And then for 3 years, I tried to get my organization to believe that it was possible. And they were like, no, Bonin, there's no way we're letting you drop a guy out of an airplane with no parachute on and no wingsuit. 3 years later, we actually did it, and here's the footage of him landing. This is the very last program that I did before I left Mondelez, and here's the video of him actually jumping out of the plane. What was interesting is that it took us 3 years to get to this place. The idea here was to create monetizable media. What I told the organization was that I was going to own the stunt, and we were going to sell it to Fox, and that's what we ended up doing. We made close to $9 million, almost double what the advertising budget for Stride Gum was. You're going to see him taking his parachute off. The day before he was about to jump, I get a phone call from the woman who ran this program, and she was in tears. She said, they're not going to let him jump without a parachute. They deemed the stunt unsafe. So we spent the next 24 hours getting green light to actually allow him to jump without a parachute. You see him turning over like this? It's because if he lands on the net that he's going to land on this way, then he'll smash like a taco. So he has to, at the very last minute, right here, he has to turn over and then lands in the net. You see where he landed on the net? The crazy thing is that he did 98 test jumps 98 test jumps where he would jump, and right before he landed on the net, he would pull his parachute. Every single one of those 98 jumps, he was dead center. The net's 100 by 100 feet. Every single one of them, on those test jumps, he was dead center, 50-50, dead center. The one that actually counted, he was 30 feet off of center. I was like, look, here's the problem, Luke. If you do not land on this net, I will lose my job. I don't care what happens to you. My job means something to me. So finally he landed on the net and I quit, and that was the very last thing that I did before I left. But what I learned throughout the last two decades was, you know, everybody told me that there was no way that a company could own media and actually make money off of it, and we did that. I began to identify trends and execute on them, and that's where I want to talk to you about today, and that's where our story begins. So if you were a marketer in the 1950s, and I came into your office and I said, look, I really want you to invest in this thing called television. You say, you know what, Bonin, look, I really want you to get out of my office because this thing called radio works really well for me. But three bold brands identified a trend. They saw that consumer consumption of media began to eclipse where investment was going, and they decided to jump into television, Unilever, P&G, and Coke. And as a result of that, they created competitive advantage that transformed their business for as long as we can probably think, for the last 50, 60 years. So again, they identified a trend and they executed on it. And so how do we begin to look at our world today? Well, I would argue that mobility is the same thing. 39% of media is consumed on a mobile device, but still less than 10% of spending actually goes into mobility. How do you identify that trend and execute on it? The challenge is that most boardrooms in the world look something like this, which is there's somebody at the front, usually a CEO, who says, you know what, I think we need a mobile strategy. And then finally somebody looks up from their device very distracted and says, I'm sorry, but did you say something? But what's interesting, it's not just an example of boardrooms, but it's an example of humanity across the world. We have become the most distracted society in human history. But the amazing thing is that we will never admit that we're distracted. We'll tell you, no, keep talking to me while I'm texting because I'm doing something that I call multitasking. But the reality is they're actually lying to you. There was a study that was done by the American Psychiatric Association. They took two groups. They asked one to use their mobile phones to multitask, and they asked the second group to smoke marijuana. And there was a 10-point drop in the IQ of those that use mobile phones to multitask, which was twice as much as those who smoke marijuana. So if you take anything away from me today, it's that you're better off being a pothead than pretending that you can multitask. But even in the face, thank you, sir. But even in the face of these glaring facts, I still get the same question. But Bonin, we understand television because we've been doing it for God knows how many years, but we don't understand is mobility at scale. So I said, such a good question. I did a little bit of research. It turns out there are 7 billion people on Earth, 5.1 billion own a cell phone and text, and only 4.2 billion own a toothbrush. Which means there are a billion people in this world that didn't get the text message on the importance of hygiene. But it also means if you believe that toothbrushes are at scale, then clearly mobile phones are. I've updated the research a little bit to look at a more millennial generation, because I always get the same question. Millennials, what does the younger generation care about? So it turns out 96% of them own a cell phone, 93% own a toothbrush, but only 90% actually use deodorant. 10% of an entire generation smell, that's what I'm trying to tell you people. So I love this next slide. It says, honk if you love Jesus, text while driving if you want to meet him. Even our religious institutions understand the importance of mobility, but still organizations are slow to move on. How many people in here have ever thought that their phone was vibrating, but when they reached in their pocket to check it, they realized it wasn't? Raise your hand. It's every single one of you. The rest of you are just lying. It's actually a disease. It's called phantom vibration syndrome. And what they talk about is people who experience it have a tactile hallucination, very similar to meth addicts, to drug addicts. So it's literally a drug. Other studies show that using your mobile phone and text messaging is as addictive as cocaine, which means there's somebody in a dark alley going, oh my God, please just send me a text message. Just send me an emoji or a bitmoji. And they're feeding and they're dying for us to send them some type of text because they're strung out. And while this technology has taken huge impact on us from a business perspective, many times we don't think about it from a societal perspective. And that's what I began to notice. I began to try to identify the trend and execute on it. And you're gonna hear me talk a lot about how do you think that way inside your organization? How do you identify what's trending and then execute on it? When I first came into Mondelez about 5 years ago, mobility was early. And I began to identify that trend. but I began to execute on it. And what I gave to the organization was a mantra, which was getting to 10. Our goal as the seventh largest buyer in the world was that we were gonna spend 10% of all of our media dollars around the globe in mobility. People didn't believe it was possible. That made us close to a $200 million mobile spender, the largest at the time in CPG. Ultimately, we ultimately became, you know, campaign featured us. We did this across Asia Pac, across Europe, across the US. Ultimately became the number one mobile marketer for that the next 2 years because we were actually investing behind the trend that we identified and actually executing on it. One of the programs that we executed on was the number one branded game in history, which is crazy. So the story is pretty simple. Two brands came to me, two gum brands. They said, look, Bonin, we want to build mobile games. I said, great, let me introduce you to people who build mobile games for a living. He said, no, we don't need your people. We got this. I said, okay, you know where it's going, right? So we got this. And so, you know, both brands spent $1 million. One got 16,000 downloads, one got 25,000 downloads. I was so pissed off. I said, you know what? I'm gonna find a brand marketer, actually trust me, because I'm really smart. I'm innovative AF, if you guys haven't seen the t-shirt. But I'm really smart, and we're gonna crush it. And once we crush it, I'm gonna shove it in their face because that's my management style. So I found the Oreo brand marketer. And we took $175,000 and I went to a game developer in New Zealand named Pickpock. And I gave them three things. I said, one, don't desecrate the Oreo, because if you desecrate the Oreo, I will hunt you down and the sheep that you lay with, because they're from New Zealand, sheep, no? Okay, anyway, two, if you can get the ritual of Twist, Lick, and Dunkin', that's great, but three is the most important. I want you to make the game make money. Because I knew if I gave them this idea of making the game make money, that they create a piece of content that was actually valuable that people cared about. Long story short, the game was number one app in 12 countries, 12 million organic downloads, 20 billion Oreos dunked. It's still going, you can still download, you can still play it, it's still brought to you by Pickpock. But the most important thing is the game actually made money. So if you think about it, 12 million downloads for a mobile app, for a game is huge. For a branded game, unheard of. Number one downloaded branded game in history. But the idea was identify a trend. The trend for me was if I can monetize it, if I can give these guys an opportunity to actually create what they do for a living, making money off games, then maybe I can create a better platform. Again, identify the trends and execute on them. So, during this time, a little bit after this, I moved to China and I began to write a book. And I began to realize that the world was vastly changing. We talk about mobile, but there was something even more specific than mobile which was happening, which was messaging. And so in 2011, if you look, there was only one app in the top 10 downloaded apps that was a messaging app, and that was Skype. Skype is not even on the map anymore. Anybody work for Skype here? Because if so, quit, I apologize. Anyway, it's not gonna work out for you. No, but now if you look at it, six, soon to be seven of the top 10 downloaded apps in the world are messaging apps. 5 billion people actually use messaging today across the globe. 4 out of 5 minutes are spent inside of a messaging app. So I began to ask myself, oh my God, attention, consumer attention is shifting to this platform called messaging. Forget about mobility. Mobility is almost old news. We are now focused on one single task, which is how do I send a text or a message or something with inside that platform for a consumer? If you look at all the investment that's happening, the transformations that are happening with iMessage, so the new emoji, scanning your face emoji, or if you look at the new app platform inside of iMessage, or if you look at the investments that's being put into WhatsApp in terms of corporate messaging, messaging is going to be a transformational platform. And the crazy thing to me is that very few brands are actually participating or connecting with their consumers in this space. There is an entire generation that doesn't know that email actually exists. For them, the only thing that exists is messaging. And you have to ask yourselves, all these companies that have built capabilities around email, what are they going to do? What happens in a world where you can only send a message? And many people haven't identified that trend or executed on it. And so I decided to do that. So literally, I wrote a book called Text Me, where I put my phone number on the cover. The funny story was, the original title of the book was actually Digilence. And originally, I wanted to find a publisher who we could change publishing with. And I found this publisher, and they were like, Bonin, we love you. We want to change publishing. Digilence is going to be this big book. And then I was sitting in a coffee shop with the researcher, Luke, who's actually backstage. Yeah. And we came up with this concept of putting my phone number on the cover. And I thought it was so brilliant. I ran back to the publisher and I said, guess what? We're going to put my phone number on the cover of a book. And they were like, that's the worst idea ever. Get out. I get kicked out of a lot of rooms. So you can tell. They were like, we didn't really want to transform publishing. We just wanted to get your book deal, you moron. So I bought the rights of the book back. And we named it what I wanted to name it. Best thing I've ever done. The point of the book was to be the Freakonomics of the mobile generation. And what I wanted to do was write a book that looked at the untalked about and undiscussed impact that mobility was having on every single aspect of life, from dating to religion to memory to parenting and relationships, so on and so forth. And it's 120 interviews with everybody from Pharrell to Dick Costello, who was the CEO of Twitter at the time, to the head of Coca-Cola, to the owners of the Dodgers and the Warriors, so on and so forth, and everybody in between. But the one thing I realized as I began to write and talk to people was that I wasn't talking to enough people, that the impact of this device was so much bigger than I understood, that I actually had to talk to more people. So we put my phone number on the cover, and to date we've texted with 12,000 people. We can make it 12 million if every single one of you text me. My phone number is here, just FYI. Oddly enough, the next slide is actually text me. If you do text me right now, I want to show you some of the platforms that I've been using in order to manage my relationships, and I'm going to talk about what findings and what those relationships look like. But please feel free to text me. If you include New Mexico, you will get a surprise. My phone number will be on the slides on the bottom as we go forward. I have been investing in messaging technology companies, so if there are any early stage startups in the messaging space, hunt me down, find me. We are aggressively investing. We have 14 companies in the portfolio to date, going to 50 by the end of the year. One of the companies that I invested in is called Zingle. Zingle actually powers my messaging, so I have some technology behind it, and I'll explain why that's important. But I want to talk a little bit about some of the findings. So what's interesting is, oh, here we go, I'm blowing up right now. Thank you, people. When I launched the book at South by Southwest, we did a test. And I asked one question. I said, what's the last thing you look at before you go to sleep? Your partner or your cell phone? 80% of people said I look at my cell phone. One guy was so pissed. He said, Bonin, I hate you so much. Now I have to make it a point to look at my partner before I go to bed instead of my cell phone. I said, you're welcome, and I charge for dating advice. Just text back, yes, I'll auto bill. By the way, I'll auto-bill all of you who are texting me. And that's what we asked. But it was interesting because it's truly transforming relationships. We talked to a younger generation, and a younger generation, the female said, you know what, we love platforms like Tinder because it's a double opt-in. I no longer feel preyed upon in these dating scenarios. Men said, you know what, I love it because I no longer have to be nervous of rejection. So now I don't have to go into a bar and try to talk to a woman. They say no to me. I know they want to see me because they swipe right on me. I was like, you know what? I hate you because I spent my whole life being rejected, and it builds character, people. We need to focus. We also talked a lot about parenting. What do you think the average age that you would give a kid a cell phone is? Somebody shout out a number. 12. Who said 12 over here? Raise your hand real quick. Somebody said 12. 12. Okay, good. The Mexico's going to give you a gift. I don't know what it is. They'll figure it out. No. Text us and tell me you said 12 and we'll get you an innovative AF shirt. Anyway, 12 was the average age. But the most interesting thing that I found was, I'm still getting texts, thank you people, we're gonna write back. The thing that I found that was the most interesting was parents talked to us about the removal of hierarchy. So there used to be a time when you were a parent, you could tell a kid, look, do not smoke marijuana. I don't care what Bonin says, and that was it. They could ask why, they had no way to check whether it was good. That was it, my word mattered. Now, they're like, well, that's funny because your best friend from college just put photos up on Facebook of you doing bong hits in college and you seem like you did okay. So the removal of hierarchy or the death of rebellion. The death of rebellion. I used to be able to tell my mom, I'm going to Little Jimmy's house. And then maybe I'd go someplace else in between. As long as I finally made it to Little Jimmy's house at some point in time, it didn't really matter. But now, literally, kids have a GPS in their pocket. Carolyn Everson, the number two at Facebook, who I was on stage with 2 years ago here, said to me in our interview, she said, I can't wait until we put a chip in the heads of my daughters so I know where they are every single moment of time. I was like, Jesus, I'm so happy I'm not your daughter, Carolyn. This is some scary stuff here, Carolyn. But this idea of the death of rebellion. When I went to college, I used to talk to my parents maybe once a week if I was lucky or unlucky, depends on how you look at it, right? But now there's a continual conversation between kid and parent. So if this was supposed to be the moment in time when you left your parental unit and you became the person you were going to be, does that moment still exist? What happens to that moment? But I told you, identify trends and execute on it, right? The other thing we learned, 80% of newborn babies have their photo up on Facebook in the first hour of their birth. So the very first thing they see is the iPhone, or maybe Android. It's Europe, so I don't know. You guys cheap people out here. Anyway, so the first thing they see, dad standing there with the camera going, okay, I'm smile, please smile. And the baby's like, ah, I can't smile, I'm being born. Can we do this later? But I realized there was an opportunity, 20%. So ladies and gentlemen, I executed on this, and I give you the Nelfie, the newborn selfie, people. No child left behind. We are too good of a generation to allow this to happen. We've also turned pee time into me time. People told us stories. I asked, what's the thing you hate the most about you and yourself? And they said, the thing I hate the most is I take it to the bathroom with me. I said, you know what I hate the most? I hate that you told me that you take it to the bathroom with you. I'm a perfect stranger, and I'm texting you from the stall. Let's get real about this. People told us stories about lying to their friends about having to go to the restroom during dinner because they wanted to check Instagram or Facebook. And so here's the social construct that we created, which says it's inappropriate for you to check your phone while you're in a social setting. So now we actually have to create lies to the people who we care about in order to go do the thing that we care about really the most, which is our phone. The other day I was at dinner, and it was last night actually. And first of all, I love New Mexico. This is a great event. So many great people. I had so many great conversations. Last night we were at dinner. I realized there's like 12 of us sitting around this table in the Hilton. And all of a sudden, one person looks down to text. And then literally, you can see the person look at the other person. Oh, he's texting? I can text now too. And all 12, all around the table, were like, heads down. It was like there's a queue. Like somebody starts the queue. And it's like, okay, we're good. We're good on text for a moment. Okay, hey, we're back in this conversation with people. Hey, what's up, guys? So we've turned pee time into me time. But the thing that I found the most interesting about my experience of texting with people, and every single one of you will get, so I'll talk a little bit about where I see the future. I don't think it's bots or knots. I think that there's this idea of humanation, where it is, how do I use automation to create the human actions that I want, but at the same time still have a human engagement with you? So it's a combination of automation and human engagement. And I'll show examples of that. You guys, many of you are getting an automated response. You'll get a personal message directly from me, and we'll talk and we'll go into detail around any question you have or any of your thoughts on the responses that you give me. So I'll actually be talking to you. And that's how I learned how to figure out how to text with 12,000 people. But the thing I find most interesting about all of this is the personal nature of this platform. What we don't realize is that the promise of social was that it was going to be one-to-one engagement. We were going to have personal relationships with consumers. The reality was it was still just a mass blast platform. But now I'm texting with you. I'm talking to you in the platform when you talk to your loved ones, your children, where if your daughter doesn't respond to you, the very first thing you are concerned about is she okay? These platforms mean so much to you, so much so that you're willing to reveal or discuss things that you wouldn't in other platforms. And here's an experience that I had. I'm just going to pull it up so I can actually read the actual text. So look, I get a ton of text messages. People see a number on the book. They don't know what to do. They're like, ah, what is this? So they'll send me stuff like, hey. I'm like, that's pretty lazy. So I'm like, hey, back. There you go. Oh, they'll be like, hi. I'm like, again, take some time to think about something. So then I'm just like, hi, back to you. Figure it out from there. I don't know who texts me. I don't know the person. So I just get a number. So the initial response is pretty anonymous. So here's a person who wrote me. Later on, I found out what their name was. I'll tell you later. They write hi. So I write hi back. They go, took you long enough. For a number found on the title of a book, I thought I'd get a response much sooner. LOL. Gotta put LOL so you know I'm being jovial. It's like, thanks for explaining what LOL means to me. I wrote a whole book called Text Me with my phone number on the cover. I think I got the LOL thing down. But thanks for just bringing that up. I mean, it's not a textbook, it's a marketing book. You should get an autoresponder for this number. I happen to be traveling, so I write back. I said, yeah, didn't want to do an autoresponder because it didn't feel genuine, but did you read the book? No, I was browsing the section where the book was and curiosity kicked in. So I wrote, well, glad you were curious enough to text, but I must say it's a good book if you ever have a chance to read it. LOL. Bam, right back at you. There you go. I'll give it a look over next time I'm in Barnes. Apparently Barnes is a short abbreviation for Barnes and Nobles. They're probably going out of business. So Barnes, then B, you know, eventually it'll be, they don't exist. Anyway, you see what Amazon's doing to the world, which we can talk about on text later. I don't even know what it's about. I just thought it was interesting to see what happens when I text a number. I go, look, it's the mobile, it's about mobile culture, think Freakonomics of a mobile generation, looks at the undiscussed and not talked about impact that mobile has on every aspect of life, from dating to religion to memory and more. She writes back, ha, ha, ha. Here, we got a new slide for it. Okay, oops, I think we got the wrong slide. Anyway, so, oh, we had the right slide before. Sorry, there's people in the back. There we go, this is what she writes back, ha, ha, ha. Speak of dating, definitely ruined my last relationship. I was a texter, he was a caller, we were due from the start. LOL. I'm like, I don't know if there's anything funny about this. Like, I don't know if that's the appropriate place to put LOL right now. So I go, do tell me more. Actually, the book is interviews from 120 people, and I decided to put my number on the cover so I could talk to people about how it changed in their lives. Did you guys meet on a dating app? She goes, no, we were college sweethearts. I said, so how did the phone bring on what you think was the inevitable? She writes back, I find that because I text so much, I have a hard time articulating myself on my feet. You can't Google the definition of a word mid-conversation to make sure you're using it correctly. You can't take too long to respond or people will perceive you as not too bright. You can't edit your words mid-conversation. My ex is a life coach, motivational speaker, soon-to-be author, Marine, and has the charisma of a politician. Communicating with him was a struggle for me. I even had panic attacks when I need to communicate anything serious to him. So now I'm like, wow, I think this conversation is a little bit out of my league. I don't know if I'm actually educated enough to have this conversation. She writes, me, I'm just your average receptionist with dreams of being an entrepreneur, but no ideas of how to materialize them or where to start. So I wrote back, send me your idea, I'd love to help you out. She never wrote back. So maybe she's not gonna be an entrepreneur, but it was interesting the level of personal nature that she was willing to share with me in these platforms. And so that made me understand that, first of all, I was like, you know what, we're done here, I have to move on. But it made me realize that there's an opportunity in these, thank you, an opportunity in these platforms for us to have personal communication with consumers on a level that we never saw possible. So I began to look at that in a new business that I invested in, which is a beauty business. And I began to look at a platform called Superphone, which allows you to have automation and human communication. So it's a beauty business. So we launched our very first automated platform in Messenger. So now every single Facebook ad that you click on from us actually drops you into a Messenger conversation. They happen to have hair care, so we ask a simple question, which is, what hair type are you? You select, you choose from your hair type. Let's say that's the hair type you choose. We then text you back and we say, okay, great. Here's a video on how to tame your hair. So after I ask you, here's a video on how to tame your hair, I recommend, does this match your struggles? You say yes, I now recommend a product for you. Then I ask you, where do you shop? Target, Walgreens, Carrefour, you name it. After you tell me where you shop, I then give you a coupon, as well as I allow you to buy now or I give you a coupon. And more importantly, after that, I drop you into a conversation with an actual beauty specialist. So what's great about that interaction is, in a very simple interaction, and this is why the answer to the question, bot or not, which is that I don't believe it's about automation, but I believe it's human, I drop you into a conversation with a beauty specialist. But what I just did there was I got three pieces of very important data that I could never get anywhere else. I got, what's your hair type? What product do I recommend to you? And where do you shop? And then hopefully on the back end, I get, did you redeem a coupon? And then hopefully I have deeper conversations with you about your beauty needs, and I can bring you deeper into our beauty care business. So access to data, hyper-personal, and again, it's not bot or not, but in this messaging world, I believe the winners are gonna be those that can use automation as well as human connection. And so many of the platforms that I've invested in Bond and Ventures, have been platforms that do customer service, like Pipestream on the far left, or Superphone that allow automation. So think of things like Buddy Media, but for the messaging generation. I think there's three big areas, which are SMS management tools. What are the platforms that are gonna actually manage my communication with consumers over time? What are those that are gonna provide deals, offers, some type of redemption? And what are those that are gonna provide rich media and content? We don't think about this, but if you really think, how many platforms out there now do email newsletters? All of those things have to be reinvented for a messaging type space, and who's going to do that? So I want to leave you with this. I know I'm running out of time, which is, how do you rethink? How do you identify the trends, no matter what they are? I happen to be focused on messaging and investing highly in messaging today. How do you rethink everything you're doing today, identify trends that can transform your business, and then most importantly, how do you execute on them? And then also importantly, watch B-Suite. We do film, we do a weekly show where we interview people who have ideas that are changing the world, where we talk about trends that we think matter to the future. Anyway, it has been amazing to be with you guys in Mexico. Please text me, and thank you so much for your time.